out of those prophets, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam tested one of the most. But who were the people that he was surrounded by? Who did he surround himself with? What do we call them? What's their label? The Sahaba. And what are they known as? The greatest generation. Why? Partially, in part, because they experienced that difficulty with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So their bonds of brotherhood were so close, so tight. They were such close homies with each other that they would go through thick and thin. We call it ride or die. Like, I'm there with you. If you're going through difficult times, your initial reaction is going to be to pull yourself away, to not interact with people, to become isolated, to say, I need time by myself. But don't become comfortable being alone, because that's when shaitan, the wolf, will attack the lone sheep. So you need to make sure that you surround yourself with people who are uplifting, who are spiritually facilitating. They help you do the right thing, make the right decision at the right time. And they aid you in your path to recovery. Because really, let's be honest, when someone got into a fight with their friends or their mom or their loved ones, when you get into an argument or a fight, or someone just gets laid off or put through some difficult time, then sometimes you're not really in the mood to get up and pray. Sometimes you're not really in the mood to do these things. Sometimes you are, and that's great. But sometimes you're not really, you feel so beaten down that you say, I'm just tired. And that's when your friends will be the ones who say, get up. Come on, get up, let's pray. Trust me, if we pray together, I promise you it's the beginning of the recovery. You'll feel better. But if you don't have that suhbah, then you're going to be sitting there by yourself saying, I'm just tired. And there's going to be no one around you saying, get up. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us these characteristics. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us with the ability to recognize difficulty, be perseverant through difficulty, and also make sure that we never judge other people and surround ourselves with good people. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to practice all that has been said and heard. Jazakumullah khair. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive me for speaking in a gathering of people who are much more knowledgeable than myself. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, nastaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We thank Brother Abdurrahman Murphy for his inspiring lecture to us all. And inshallah, we'll be having a session right now with Dr. Munir al-Qasim. A little bit about Dr. Munir al-Qasim. He was born in Beirut, Lebanon in 1955. He was educated at the Al-Maqasid Islamic Institute, where the foundation of his Islamic knowledge was established. He was a top student to be admitted in the pre-medicine program at the university in Beirut. And following his migration to Canada, he continued his studies at the University of Western Ontario, earning a master's degree in medical genetics, thereafter joining the University of Toronto to graduate as a dental surgeon in 1986. After spending 15 years in general practice, he joined the University of Western Ontario as an assistant professor at the Faculty of Medicine and Dentistry. Without further ado, I would like to call upon Dr. Munir al-Qasim. It seems that Dr. Munir al-Qasim isn't here right now, so inshallah, we will be having a Quranic recitation by Hafiz Bilal.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تكونوا كالذين آذوا موسى فبرأه الله مما قالوا وكان عند الله وجيها يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما إنا عرضنا الأمانة على السماوات والأرض والجبال فأبين أن يحملنها وأشفقن منها وحملها الإنسان إنه كان ظلوما جهولا ليعذب الله المنافقين والمنافقات والمشركين والمشركات ويتوب الله على المؤمنين والمؤمنات وكان الله غفورا رحيما صدق الله العظيم
Takbir. Alhamdulillah, Jazakallah Bilal for the beautiful recitation. Dr. Munir Al Qasim is running a little late, so we have Sheikh Abdul Nasir Jangdar who will be giving us a talk for 5-10 minutes on the same topic as Dr. Munir Al Qasim, inshallah. Jazakallah.
بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته So inshallah I'll be talking a little later this evening inshallah on the topic that was assigned and addressed to me but the topic for this session was about the dwellers of the cave Ashabul Kahf that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about in the Quran And while inshallah the esteemed speaker arrives, I figured I would get here and just offer a little bit of just some very humble thoughts on this particular, you know, issue that is mentioned in the Quran. A little bit. Something very fascinating and very interesting. I'll mention something about the surah itself, Suratul Kahf. It's named after the cave itself, Ashabul Kahf. Is of course the people of the cave, which refers to those young men who took refuge in a cave. What's very interesting is that in the Arabic language there are two words for cave that are very commonly used. There's the word ghar, like we hear about the Prophet ﷺ going to the ghar of Hira, right? That means cave. While there is another type of cave that is called kahf. Kahf is a cave that is very wide open. It has a wide opening to it. Now, we all know, just as a very basic fact, you can consider this like basic Islamic trivia, we know that Suratul Kahf is something that the Prophet ﷺ told us to recite every Friday, every week, on Jumu'ah, the day that the whole community congregates, the day that we come and we sit and we listen to a khutbah and we listen to a reminder. And that day serves as a motivation and as an inspiration, as the driving force sometimes behind the rest of the week. Why did the Prophet ﷺ tell us to recite Suratul Kahf on Friday? What is it about Suratul Kahf that makes it the perfect thing to recite on a Friday? A lot of times the reason why do we recite Suratul Kahf? Because the Prophet ﷺ told us. But why did the Prophet ﷺ tell us to recite this surah out of 114 surahs in the Quran? Why this one particular surah did he recommend to be recited every single Friday? And the scholars explain, the Mufassirun, they explain because in this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about four major scenarios, four major stories that are talked about in this surah. There's of course the story of the people of the cave. The second one is the story about the man with two gardens. The third is tells us about Musa alayhi salam in Khidr. And the fourth and the final one tells us about a great king by the name of Dhulqarnain. And these four different stories revolve around the idea, like Brother Murphy was just talking about, Ustad Abdurrahman was just talking about, persevering through tests. This talks about the four different types of ways, the four different elements that a person will be tested with. Ashabul Kahf is the test of faith, the test of belief, the test of iman. The second story, which talks about the man with two gardens, that is the test of wealth, of money, materialism. The third story tells us about the test of knowledge and containing and managing one's realization of oneself because of knowledge. And fourthly and finally, it's about the test and the trial of power. That when someone has authority, somebody has power, how do you go about in dealing with this? And the reason why this is read and recited every single Friday by believers worldwide is not just to simply recite it as a ritual. That's the greatest tragedy for the ummah today. That we read and recite the Quran. Is there reward in reciting the Quran if you still don't understand it? Absolutely. You know why there's reward for reciting the Quran even if you don't understand it? Because it's the word of Allah. It's the kalam of Allah. I oftentimes explain to my students, and when I teach them tafsir, I explain to them, you know, Allah tells us in the Quran that all of the creation of Allah praises and glorifies Allah. A lot of times a human being thinks he or she is special because we're the only ones who pray to Allah, who worship Allah, who remember Allah. Allah tells us that's not the case. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, وَإِن مِّن شَيْءٍ إِلَّا يُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِهِ وَلَكِنْ لَا تَفْقَهُونَ تَسْبِيحَهُمْ. There's not a single thing in the creation of Allah that does not praise and glorify their Creator, their Lord, and their Master, Allah. وَلَكِنْ لَا تَفْقَهُونَ تَسْبِيحَهُمْ. We don't have the ability to understand their praise and glorification of Allah. And you know, so the basic things, like the Quran tells us, when we hear thunder in the clouds, that is the praise and the glorification of Allah. When animals, when birds chirp and animals make the noises that they make, that is the remembrance and the praise and the glorification of Allah. Even the inanimate things, the things that we don't perceive to be alive, when the leaves, you know, when the wind blows in the tree and the leaves are blowing in the wind and it makes noise, that is the praise and glorification of Allah. When it rains, like right now, and you hear the raindrops falling, that is the praise and glorification of Allah. However, so if all of the creation of Allah praises and glorifies Allah, then the human being isn't special, but all of the creation of Allah envies the human being. They envy the human being because the human being is the only creation of Allah that has been given the ability to praise, to glorify, to worship Allah using the words of Allah. I mean, do we ever think and realize that? This Quran, when we say Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, when the brother was reciting the Quran a little while ago, do we comprehend the fact that right now I am listening to the same exact words that Allah spoke? Subhanallah. So yes, there is a reward for reciting the Quran if you don't understand it, because these are the words of Allah. However, you will not fully attain and achieve the benefit of it unless and until you understand what you're reading and reciting. It's very important. This is the first and foremost basic step and the first part of the journey, the spiritual journey that every believer takes. You know, and I'll kind of move into this specifically. The first test Allah talks about, the people of the cave, is a test of faith, is a test of iman. But there's relevance here. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, listen, one other thing that you have to remember about the Quran, about the eloquence of the Quran, the fact that it is divine speech, it is the word and the kalam of Allah. There's one thing you have to acknowledge and appreciate about the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about the Ashabul Kahf, about these people who were in the cave, who sought refuge in the cave to protect their iman. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, innahum fityatun, إِنَّهُمْ فِتْيَةٌ They were young people, they were youth. Nothing in the Quran is coincidental. Nothing in the Quran is just a random fact. Nothing in the Quran is irrelevant. Everything Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about, everything Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions is relevant. Why did Allah teach us and talk to us about the test of iman, the test of faith, by telling us about younger people? Because the test of faith will be a lot more difficult and will be a lot more trying and testing for younger people. It's a reality. And so when we talk specifically about the Quran, because where did we get the topic about the people of the cave, the dwellers of the cave? It's from the book of Allah. It comes from the Quran. One huge issue behind the crisis of faith that is so common in our communities today. If you don't think that it's common that people, young people, struggle with their faith and their belief and their iman, you're burying your head in the sand. Get out there, talk to people, walk amongst the people, interact with the people, and you'll see it's a very common problem. It's a plague. And a fundamental reason and issue behind that is that we don't have any connection with the Book of Allah. Look, it's not an exaggeration at all to say that all the answers are here. Allah said, وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ الشِّفَاء This is the cure. This is the solution to the problem. I'll tell you all a personal story. I know Brother Murphy shared a lot of very fascinating, you know, really heart-shaking stories with you. I'll share a story with you. I had a young man come to me who was going to college. So there's a university right by where I live, and I'll go there and do a lot of programs and activities from time to time. My own cousins and stuff, I used to teach actually at that university. So a young Muslim man comes to me and he says, you know, I've been attending the Bible study groups and the Christian groups on campus, and I'm really seriously like confused and even considering, you know, joining their group and accepting Christianity. So I started talking to him and realizing what the problem is. I asked him a question. I said, will you be, you know, when do they meet? This Bible study group, when do they meet? He said, they meet every Wednesday. I asked him, will you be going? He said, yeah, I've been going for a few weeks. I'll be going. So I said, I'd like for you to do me a favor. I advise you don't go, but I can't force you not to go. So I'm going to ask you at least to do me, if you do go, then I'll ask you to do me one favor. The favor is that when you go there, ask them how many of them have read the entire Bible from cover to cover. How many of them have read the entire Bible in English from cover to cover? So when I met him the following week, I said, did you go to the Bible study group? He said, yep. Said, how many people were there? 20 people. Okay. Did you ask them how many people have read the Bible cover to cover? He said, yeah, I did. How many? He said, 15 of them. 15 out of 20 young Christians on campus had read the Bible cover to cover. I asked him, have you read the Quran? Even once in your life? In translation at the very least. From cover to cover? Do you have that much a relationship with the Book of Allah? He said, no. I just told him, don't you think if you're going to make such a huge decision about your life, that you owe it to yourself to do the research? So I gave him a translation of the Quran. And I said, at least start reading this. I met this young man again. I actually avoided him for a few weeks because I didn't want him to think I was like, you know, harassing him or... I didn't want him to be reading it for me. I wanted him to really honestly read it and not feel any pressure. I met him the next time after a few weeks. And the next time I met him, before I could say anything, before I could ask, how's it going? What's going on? How are things? Before I could say anything, he tells me, he goes, I'm good. I'm set. So what do you mean? He's like, I went home and I started reading. And I couldn't put it down. And I kept reading. I'd wake up in the morning and I'd read. During lunch break, I'd read. Between classes, I would read. In the evening, I would read. At night, when I would lay down in bed, I'd leave on my lamp and I would read. And I couldn't stop reading. And eventually, that reading turned into believing. There is a crisis of faith. There is a trial of faith that we will all deal with, and especially younger people. But like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, they went and they sought refuge in the cave. We need to go and seek refuge in where we learned about the cave. And that is the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So just as a few words, inshallah, to just kind of get things started. You know, definitely take your relationship with the Qur'an very seriously and try to build a relationship with the Qur'an. We have Dr. Munir here with us now, inshallah, so we'll definitely all benefit from him much, much more. So jazakum Allah khairan, and I'm going to pass it on to Dr. Munir.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I just need time to breathe, you know, from the difficult drive. You know, it was extremely heavy rain on the way from London. And alhamdulillah, we are here now. Now, I wonder if this light is necessary because, you know, I cannot see now. Is it necessary? Whoever is looking after this light. Jazakallah khair, akhi. Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah. That's better. That's better. Alhamdulillah wa ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man walah. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. My dear brothers and listening sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I just want to make sure that everybody knows what the topic is. If I ask anyone, do you know the topic of what I'm going to talk about? Anybody? What is it? People of the cave. So all the speakers are talking about people of the cave, right? Is that correct? No. So what is it that I'm talking about concerning people of the cave? Identity. Okay. So do you have any idea how to connect the question of identity with the people of the cave? Anybody? Just say, yes, we do have an idea, or we don't know. It's just a story. Anybody who has an idea, you do? You do? Okay, alhamdulillah. Okay. Now, the story of the people of the cave was mentioned in the surah called Al-Kahf, the cave. And we know that it is one of four stories mentioned in that surah, and it is so important that it is recommended that we read it and repeat it and study it every week. And when, what day? On Jumu'ah, to give us that boost for the rest of the week. It's so important that we understand what does this story imply. So we are going to talk about this story from the surah called Al-Kahf. But before I start, I'm not going to talk about surah Al-Kahf. I'm going to start by talking about surah An-Nisa. And now, if I can catch your attention, say, what's the relationship? What do you mean? You were asked to talk about the story of the people of the Kahf, the cave. Why do you want to go to Surah An-Nisa? Because I'm asked to talk about identity. That's why I found the connection in Surah An-Nisa. So everybody is with me, and I'm going to take us on a journey, very quick journey, through Surah An-Nisa, Surah number 4 of Al-Quran Al-Kareem. Abdullah ibn Abbas. May Allah be pleased with both of them. Now, when I say Abdullah ibn Abbas, how many persons I'm talking about? Two. So Abdullah ibn Abbas is two persons? It's one person. So why did I say may Allah be pleased with both of them? What is it? His father. Okay, because this is just an aside. It has nothing to do with my topic. But just an aside for the young ones who are encountering this for the first time. You know, when you say Abdullah, the son of Abbas, if both of them are among the good Muslims, we just say, may Allah be pleased with both of them, with Abdullah and with Abbas, his father. Even though we are talking about just Abdullah, the son of Abbas. Is that clear? Clear? MashaAllah. Now, Abdullah ibn Abbas said that in Surah An-Nisa, the Muslim's identity is defined in 8 ayat, which to Ummat Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are better than what the sun shines over and sets from. في سورة النساء 8 آيات هي خير مما تطلع عليه الشمس وتغرب وفيها شرح لهوية المؤمن. Now, if we want to understand what is my identity, what is your identity, what is our identity, Abdullah ibn Abbas said that you should study 8 ayat in Surah An-Nisa. And I wish that, inshallah, you take this very seriously and you go, because you don't have pens and papers, you may check it from the DVD, you may check it the way you want. But I'm going to tell you the numbers of those ayat. And I'll tell you what are these ayat, so that we can study them and try to understand what is our identity as Muslims. 3 of those ayat are one after the other. And 5 of them are spread. The first ayah is ayah number 26 of Surah An-Nisa. And that's where I will make the connection with Surah Al-Kahf, which I will come to later on. And then I will continue, inshallah, what are the 8 ayat. And I know it's very difficult to absorb that right away, but you need to study it later. Today's Tarbiyah conference is not about coming just for this quick weekend and then it's over. No, we need to study. We need to follow up. We need to see what did this speaker say. How can we relate it with what the other speaker said? And keep developing that identity that we have to live with. The first ayah, ayah number 26, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يريد الله ليبين لكم ويهديكم سنن الذين من قبلكم ويتوب عليكم والله عليم حكيم. Allah wants to make things clear for you, meaning that if you will just leave it to your own opinion, to how you see things on the surface, you will miss what Allah wants from you. So the first thing in the identity ayat is Allah wants to make things clear for you. How Allah says in the Quran there are ways, as well as in the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is how things can become clearer. Number two, in this ayah, وَيَهَدِيَكُمْ سُنَنَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ, and to explain things by giving you examples of peoples who came before you. What happened to them? How did they deal with situations that are similar to the situations you will face? So when you will read about the story of the people of the cave now, you do not read it for entertainment. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants يَهَدِيَكُمْ سُنَنَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ. When you read about the story of Thamud, you will not just read it as a bedtime story for your children. You do not read the story of what happened to Fir'aun just to tell it in the Sunday or weekend school or at the Islamic school only, and then we go, no. عليك أحسن القصص. The Quran says, we tell you the best and most authentic among all the things you hear, so that you can learn from them. And we will come to one particular story, which is the story of the people of the cave. Again, I'm not coming to entertain anybody, but in the short time we have, we need to draw. How can we understand identity from that? But let us first go over the ayat of identity. And then the third thing in the first ayah, number 26, وَيَتُوبَ عَلَيْكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to understand that He is there to correct your path, to correct your mistakes that you are going to make, through a process called tawbah, repentance. Repentance is that guiding system given to you. If you use it, you will correct your path. وَلَنُذِيقَنَّهُمْ مِنَ الْعَذَابِ الْأَدْنَى دُونَ الْعَذَابِ الْأَكْبَرِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Sajda tells us that when you are touched by certain things you dislike, certain things that are painful, certain things that are not pleasant, it's because Allah wants to correct your path. To correct your path. Because if you do not correct your path, you may perish. It may be disastrous. Now consider, my dear brothers, dear children, consider. A car was invented and developed and modified in design over years. For what purpose? To facilitate movement. Cars are for movement. But every car has a brake system. A brake is designed to stop movement. So how could a car that is required to make us move be reconciled with something that stops movement? Without this system called the brake, the car will kill you. It needs a brake. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us al-hayat al-dunya, this training institution called al-dunya, for us to live. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says there is a brake system in this life. وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ. This is the brake. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says every now and then you will be touched with things that you don't like, things that hurt, things that are in the form of loss of things you like to keep. This is the break, because if you don't receive that, your car will keep on moving and it will kill you. And there are many people who do not appreciate what other people lose because they think they are just living comfortably. All of a sudden, when they think they are moving on a free highway, their vehicle goes into an accident and they're gone. But if you have that break, that modifies your movement. And this break, by the way, is a definition of what an identity of a Muslim should be. And I will come to that. I know that this is teasing us. You are mentioning identity. We still don't understand you. I'm coming. I don't intend to confuse anybody. So ayah number one in Surah An-Nisa, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us to draw our identity. Be careful. These three things. When you read about what happened to the people before you, when you know that your vehicle needs to be controlled through tawbah. And then the second ayah in Surah An-Nisa that Abdullah ibn Abbas talked about is ayah number 27. وَاللَّهُ يُرِيدُ أَن يَتُوبَ عَلَيْكُمْ وَيُرِيدُ الَّذِينَ يَتَّبِعُونَ الشَّهَوَاتِ أَن تَمِيلُوا مَيْلًا عَظِيمًا. Identity. Again, Allah just told us in ayah 26, وَيَتُوبَ عَلَيْكُمْ. Ya Allah, why are you repeating it? Why are you repeating it? Because it's very important for you to understand that this system called Tawbah should define your identity as a Muslim and interact with it. Without it, you will perish. Allah wants to accept your repentance. If you make a mistake, you can adjust. If in your identity you find you are going too far in such a path that will destroy your identity, come back. Come back through this process called, because those people who follow their whims and desires and shahwa, you know shahwa, desire, they want to kill you. Those people who say, hey man, come on, try it, it's really cool, it's good, that will kill you. You don't realize. They tell you, come. So does shaitan. Shaitan is there to say, come, follow me. Follow me. I will make you so happy. I will do this and this and that. But you know, as we read in Surah Ibrahim, shaitan, who helped shape the identity of people who thought they are so proud of their identity in dunya, who shaped that identity? Shaitan. But on the day of judgment, shaitan will say, in this group of people who are devastated, now they realize their vehicles are destroyed because of fatal accidents in dunya. And I don't mean it literally, I mean it in general. Those people who lost dunya and akhirah because they ran after false identities that shaitan made to look so beautiful. وَقَالَ الشَّيْطَانُ لَمَّا قُضِيَ الْأَمْرِ. Shaitan will address them. Shaitan who shaped their identity and they were so happy with it. You know, those hairs that stand up like this, and you know, that hair that is shaved on the both sides, and you know, the clothes that look certain ways, and the cars that can speed up, and spending on substances and all kinds of things. This is cool. This is the trend. This is what will make me happy. That's how girls run after me. And if I will have a car where there's a sound system and I can put the music that, you know, people 10 cars behind me can hear. And identity. وَقَالَ الشَّيْطَانُ لَمَّا قُضِيَ الْأَمْرِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَعَدَكُمْ وَعَدَ الْحَقِّ وَوَعَدْتُكُمْ فَأَخْلَفْتُكُمْ وَمَا كَانَ لِي عَلَيْكُمْ مِنْ سُلْطَانِ إلا أن دعوتكم فاستجبتم لي فلا تلوموني ولوموا أنفسكم ما أنا بمصرخكم وما أنتم بمصرخي. Shaitan is going to say, you know, after things are over, now it's the day of judgment. Listen, it's the day of judgment. And everybody now is looking, Allahu Akbar, this is real. What we were told is real. We can see it. We are inside it, but it's over. And now shaitan can say what was on his mind. What was on his mind? He says, verily, Allah gave you the truth, the right promise. and I promised you many things and I broke my promise. But I had no power over you. All I did is that I told you to do things and you agreed to do them. I had no power over you except I told you that. So now, don't blame me. Shaitan says, blame yourselves. But it's too late. Too late. Question of identity. Identity. Now, the third ayah of Surah An-Nisa is ayah number 28. يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ أَن يُخَفِّفَ عَنْكُمْ وَخُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ ضَعِيفًا. Ya Allah, Ya Allah. Allah says in the third ayah that defines the Muslim's believer's identity, Allah wants to make things easy for you. But you left that path and you said, no, no, no. What do you mean make things easy? When He wants me to wake up in the middle of the night to pray. How easy is that? Because shaitan makes people look at the surface and say, yeah, that's bad, it's crazy. You know, you just went to bed at 3 o'clock in the morning and now you want to wake up at 5? And they even ask you to pray what is called qiyam and this. What is this? And you know, man and man and man and man. And shaitan makes things look while you are living and searching for an identity. And everybody your age group are fitting into an identity that seems to be fun and fun and nothing but fun. Man, enjoy life. What a beautiful identity. This is easy life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, what looks easy on the surface can kill you. Not only in dunya, but will kill you in the hereafter as well. And then you will spend eternity in the hellfire because you thought that it is too difficult to wake up for Fajr. Even science says that the best time to get your boost of energy is when the ozone is at a level when you can breathe it at Fajr time. I don't want to talk science now. I don't want to talk. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, humans were created with a weak nature and that's why they need to be told what to do. So this is the third ayah. The fourth ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in ayah number 31. Now, the fourth ayah, ayah number 31 of Surah An-Nisa. إِن تَجْتَنِبُوا كَبَائِرَ مَا تُنْهَوْنَ عَنْهُ نُكَفِّرْ عَنْكُمْ سَيِّئَاتِكُمْ وَنُدْخِلْكُمْ مُدْخَلًا كَرِيمًا. If you avoid major sins, we are going, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we is Allah. We are going to forgive your other sins and we are going to make you enter a wholesome path towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, your identity requires that you gear safe of major sins. Major sins that to the others are part of their identity. It doesn't matter. If they are, I can't say it, there are young children here. But for the adults, I can talk in a discreet fashion and you will understand me. How many people go to bed without being tahir? Even through a halal relationship. Because it's not part of their identity. But a believer knows that there are certain requirements for this identity. Certain things we need to do. Even before I start in London, I will say, Allahumma anni as'aluka fi safarin ya hadha al-birra wa al-taqwa wa min al-amali ma tarda. Allahumma hawwin alayna safarana hadha. Once, you know, I had a person that I'm working on da'wah for him. He was sitting beside me. And he said, you know, Brother Munir, do you really believe that this is going to really help? I said, I believe that from the bottom of my heart. He said, but you're just saying it. I said, you know, I'm saying it, but it is communicated directly to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when He hears it, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers it. But it takes working on such an identity, whereas others will look at us and say, what is this? What is this? You're just saying it. Yes, I'm saying it, and it is communicated directly to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The fifth ayah of Surah An-Nisa is ayah number 40. 40. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَظْلِمُ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ وَإِن تَكُ حَسَنَةً يُضَاعِفْهَا وَيُؤْتِ مِنْ لَدُنْهُ أَجْرًا عَظِيمًا. Yes. Allah does not deal unjustly with anyone, even the weight of an atom. And if it is one good deed that you will do, as part of your identity again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to multiply the rewards for that good deed. And He will add a bonus on top of that. A bonus that is only known to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, now we are starting to feel that to have this identity, it may require some hard work in the beginning. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, keep going. Keep going, because I'm going to help you. I will give you the ajr and the bonus as you are seeking that identity, which the others are going to say, man, this is difficult. Man, this is going to deprive you. Alhamdulillah, I will continue. I will continue. Because what the people of the Kahf did, we're getting closer now to talk about them. So Allah does not deal unjustly, even the weight of an atom. Now, the sixth ayah is ayah number 48 of Surah An-Nisa. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ وَمَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ افْتَرَى إِثْمًا عَظِيمًا. Allah does not forgive anyone who associates partners with Him shirk. But anything less than that, Allah will consider forgiveness. And he who will take an identity based on shirk, then he had trespassed in a major way his limits. Ayah number 48 of Surah An-Nisa. So a believer has an identity based on the opposite of shirk, which is tawheed. Any identity which is not based on tawheed is not the identity of a Muslim. Tawheed is it. This is the base. This is the base. You see, this desk will not settle if there is no platform. And the platform is the basis. So there's no identity of a Muslim if we do not work on the foundation of tawheed. This is the framework of our identity. Now the seventh ayah is ayah number 110 of Surah An-Nisa. وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ سُوءًا أَوْ يَظْلِمْ نَفْسَهُ ثم يستغفر الله يجد الله غفورا رحيما. That as you are building your identity, if you make a mistake, or if you transgress against your own nafs, and then you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive you, you will find Allah forgiving, merciful. This is Allah. So keep working on your identity. And the eighth ayah, which is ayah number 148 of Surah An-Nisa, مَا يَفْعَلُ اللَّهُ بِعَذَابِكُمْ إِن شَكَرْتُمْ وَآمَنْتُمْ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ شَاكِرًا عَلِيمًا. What will Allah gain from punishing you If you are always thankful to Allah, and if you have genuine faith, so your identity should not be a shaky identity. You should be standing on your feet as a Muslim and say, I am a believer. And because of my faith, I will do anything. Because of my faith, I will even go to a cave and stay in that cave. Can you see the connection now, how we are getting to Surah Al-Kahf and to the story of the people of the Kahf? When people look at it and say, man, this is, I mean, this story is a fairy tale. The Quran does not tell fairy tales. Go back to the first ayah that Ibn Abbas mentioned to us, ayah number 26. وَيَهْدِيَكُمْ سُبُلَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ. You know, when we are told about the story of the people of the cave and what they did and you know, how things were shaped for them, we know that because of their faith, because of their faith, they were prepared to go to a cave and stay in that cave. And now we are coming to start to understand, how can we understand the question of identity through their story. Now, from Surah Al-Nisa all the way to Surah Al-Kahf. In Surah Al-Kahf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, listen, don't read Surah Al-Kahf and, you know, be fixed on little details, because those little details don't matter. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us right away that people are going to say that they were four and their dog is the fifth, or they will say they're six and they're blah, blah, blah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala right away says, their number doesn't matter. Their number doesn't matter. It's the just of the story and their experience. Why did they go to a place? Look, a cave does not have a door to close behind them, to cover them and protect them from the king. Notice that many of the people throughout history who wanted to do something went to caves with no doors, with no gates, nothing. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to two places that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed his divine gate without a human gate. To Hira and to Thawr. Both caves, you know, a cave does not have a gate, so that you will be protected behind a closed door. And what else, when they went to that cave, they were running away from the people who will follow them. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made a situation where now if people will come and look at them, they will run away from them. لو اطلعت عليهم لوليت منهم فرارا ولملئت منهم رعبا. See, these people, these fitya who ran away from that oppressive king, they ran away. Now if people who are following them will come and look at them, their followers, they will run away from them. Look at the divine protection. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala established a system. Everything was well defined. Even the cave that was chosen for them, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them to go to, was facing north. Because it was facing north, when the sun in the morning rises from the horizon, it will give them its light, but not its direct rays. And when it will set, they will still benefit from the light, but not from the rays. They will be protected. Because imagine, you know, if you are sleeping and the sun comes just in your, you can't sleep. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala arranged every little detail. And even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this has nothing to do with identity, by the way. But these are things that are part of the story. Even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them change their position of sleep. Why? Because we know that people who are in bed for a long time, people who are really chronically ill, nurses come and they move them because they can get bed sores, because the gravity of your body on the back muscles will cause open sores, and these open sores may get infected, and then the infections will spread. And but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for 300 years made them change. You know, science tells us, you'll be surprised to hear this, some of you, that every night if you sleep 8 hours, you will be changing position without you feeling it or knowing it 38 times on average. 38 times. No. When I sleep, I just stay on one side. You think so. But even by changing a little bit, 38 times on average, if you sleep 8 hours. Because of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at the Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even that detail is taking care of it, so that your veins and arteries will not be clogged by a circulation that is now based on gravity. No, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, change. Anyway, back to identity. You know that Surah Al-Kahf was revealed in Mecca early on because the Sahaba of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the likes of Ammar and Khabbab and Mus'ab and Sumayya, were facing terrible identity crises. People were running after them, rubbing them off of their ahadun ahad identity of Bilal, who was trying to imagine, you are a slave, you are told what to do. All of a sudden Bilal wants to have his own. Slaves don't have identity. If you want to know what an identity is not, just consider a slave. And that is why the first person, and this is where I want to come to some connecting points, the first Muslim to have difficulty understanding what an identity is and work hard for it is Bilal. Yes, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was the first person who accepted Islam, but he had a very easy time building his identity, because Abu Bakr was Abu Bakr. But to have a slave build an identity was unheard of. But he maintained ahadun ahad. Allah is one. And they tried, Umayyah ibn Khalaf tried to destroy this identity physically by putting that rock and making him, you know, stay on hot sand and to do everything. But he was building his identity. He was building his identity. At that time, when the likes, and Ammar ibn Yasir, the same thing. You know, Ammar ibn Yasir and Khabbab and all of these people, when they were building their identity, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed Surah Al-Kahf. So that when they read it, they felt good that indeed, as we enter our Kahf in Mecca, which is the house of Al-Arqam ibn Abi Al-Arqam, that was the Kahf of the early Sahaba as they were building their identity waiting for the time that will be brought forth by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when their identity will flourish into little shoots of identities similar to what they were building. So they had a kahf at the house of Al-Arqam ibn Abi Al-Arqam. So their story, you know, at the time of the Romans and when Isa alayhi salam came with the message of the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.